Hi everyone. Thank you for joining today's Zoom meeting on lentiviral gene therapy for Pompe disease. I think we're going to give everybody just a second to make sure they all come in the room, and then we'll get started. And more people are joining. Hope everybody is doing well and is having nice weather. We're finally getting a break from the heat here in Texas. All right. In the interest of time, we're going to go ahead and get started. And again, thank you everyone for joining today's webinar on lentiviral gene therapy for Pompe disease. Today's guest speaker is Dr. Pim Pijnappel. Dr. Pijnappel is an associate professor at the Erasmus Medical Center and has broad expertise ranging from basic cl to clinical science. He performed his PhD research at the Hubrecht Laboratory in Utrecht, the Netherlands, and his postdoctoral research at the EMBL Heidelberg in TU Dresden in Germany. His research group at the Center for Lysosomal and Metabolic Diseases at Erasmus MC in Rotterdam, the Netherlands, focuses on basic, translational, and clinical aspects of lysosomal storage diseases, including Pompe disease and Hunter syndrome. The aim of his research is to better understand the disease mechanisms, to develop novel treatment options, and to understand genotype-phenotype relationships. He has published over 80 peer-reviewed scientific articles and holds 11 patents on therapies and biomedical technology. During the presentation, you can send questions at any time by clicking the Q&A feature at the bottom of the Zoom window. Dr. Pijnappel will answer your questions at the end of the presentation. Thank you very much. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Pijnappel. Thank you, Dr. Pijnappel.
Okay, thanks a lot, Tiffany. I will share the screen. Okay, very good. Okay, let's go. So this is the Erasmus Medical Center during the evening with a beautiful sky. And I'm trying to go to the next slide, which is not working for some reason. Yes. Okay. So I will talk about Pompe disease, what it is, and also the challenges for current treatment. Then I will go in on the lentiviral gene therapy. How does it work? I will make a small comparison with another form of gene therapy called AAV gene therapy. And I will give you a little bit of an update on the clinical development that we are now pursuing for this therapy and how we think we can bring it to patients. Yes. Okay. So Pompe disease is a lysosomal storage disorder. And it's caused by a deficiency in an enzyme called acid alpha glucosidase, which you can see here. This enzyme is responsible for the breakdown of large sugar molecules called glycogen in the lysosome. The lysosome is a factory, kind of a recycling factory of the cell. Glucose is the energy source in the cell and can be stored by putting it together in glycogen. And glycogen enters the lysosome, but cannot leave it without being degraded by this enzyme, acid alpha glucosidase, or GAA. If you miss this enzyme or when it's deficient, then glycogen will accumulate and the lysosomes will get bigger and bigger, and they will disrupt and mainly damage your muscles. So Pompe disease is a very heterogeneous disease. We have on one end of the spectrum the classic infantile phenotype, where babies are diagnosed that are very have a generalized muscle weakness. They also have an enlarged heart, they have a head lag, and they are very vulnerable, and they need to be treated with enzyme therapy, otherwise they will die within 1 year of age. We also have late onset patients of any age, and eventually they are suffering from mobility impairment and also respiratory deficiency. So at the Erasmus Medical Center, there's a large history on research for Pompe disease, which started with cloning of the gene and developing enzyme therapy, first in actually a rabbit milk and later in cells in culture. A mouse model was made and enzyme therapy was actually tested. And together with farming and later Sanofi enzyme, the enzyme replacement therapy was developed and the first clinical trial was performed in the children and adults. And that's now what's myozyme, what's on the market. Another thing that is that we are currently doing in the lab is to maintain the Pompe mutation database or the Pompe variant database, which is open open access. Everybody can have a look. And here you can actually obtain information about the severity of mutations that can cause Pompe disease. You can click on the molecular characteristics of the mutation in this variant info link, and you can also click on patients to see how many patients with these mutations have been identified in the literature. And this is described in these two publications. And we now know that at least 648 different disease-associated variants or mutations have been identified that can cause Pompe disease. You probably all know that now there's enzyme replacement therapy, the myozyme, which I just told you about, and myozyme definitely works. It can prolong lifespan, improve life quality, but also has drawbacks. It is very expensive. It needs to be given every week or every 2 weeks, and it cannot cure the brain or treat the brain. And as I will show you a bit later, this is a concern for the classic infantile patients. So the challenges for patients with Pompe disease that are really getting more and more clear are as follows. And here I apologize that this somehow, that is coming. I see what it is. This is published in this publication by Jeroen van den Dorpel, 2020, where you can see that over time, muscle function doesn't respond that well to enzyme replacement therapy and shows a decline. And there are several functions that you can identify here. And depending on the patient, so these are individual patients, these are the lower extremities, and these are the upper extremities, that both proximal and distal muscle weakness can still occur upon increasing years here. So this is for the children. And then another challenge is the involvement of the brain, where you can see here an example. This is an MRI of the brain of a classic infantile patient at the age of 8. And then, there are several, there's quite some variation actually here, but what typically can be seen is, abnormalities in the white matter near the ventricles and also here in the cortical area. And that can also go or lead to problems with with brain function. And this is something that is very worrying, because enzyme replacement therapy cannot enter the brain, so cannot treat this problem. Maybe good to realize that the brain problems do not apply to patients that do not have the classic infantile phenotype. So only classic infantile patients, as far as we know, have a brain phenotype, and all other patients don't. So that's important to realize, but still, for that patient population, it's very important that we develop a treatment option. Here, there are some data on adult patients. And here you can see a study from patients at the Erasmus MC at the effects of enzyme therapy in 10 years. Where you can see here the average response of the patient. Like this is a 6-minute walking test. You can see here initially there's quite a good response in the first 2 years. And then the enzyme therapy cannot really prevent the decline in performance in this test. There's a lot of variation here. You can see that for the lung function. So these are individual patients, and there are patients with a good response here with the improved lung function, or that stabilize actually, or that decline. And this is all in the presence of enzyme therapy. So that is also a question that we still would like very much to answer. Why are certain patients responding good to enzyme therapy, and why are they not responding that well? And this is also confirmed by a French study here, where you can also see all the variations. These are all individual lines. One line is one patient. And here you see the average, and you can see here the results for the 6-minute walking test, where you can also see initial, there's a good response in the first 2 years, and then there seems to be a decline in performance. And for the lung function, there's a steady, very slow, but steady decline in function. So we need to address these issues. And that's actually the reason to engage in developing novel therapies for Pompe disease. And it is important, if we talk about gene therapy, that at present, roughly, there are two forms that that are important to discuss. And they are quite different. This whole webinar will deal with lentiviral gene therapy, but it is still good to avoid confusion that there's also another form, and that's called AAV gene therapy. So we'll very quickly discuss the pros and the cons of each form of gene therapy to indicate the difference. So to start with the AAV mediated gene therapy, AAV stands for adeno-associated virus. So this is a virus that contains a copy of the GEA gene, and it can deliver the gene to the patient. How does it do that? That depends on the type of AAV virus that is used. So there are many different types, and you can target blood cells, muscle cells. You can use it intrathecally, so near the spinal cord, or directly into the brain or the brain ventricles. So that is all different applications. And the delivery itself can be easy, although the brain is of course much more difficult, and the intrathecal, but it's quite doable. So these are the pros, the advantages, and the advantages is also it does not incorporate it into the host DNA. So it stays outside the DNA, the genetic material of the cell. And that is an advantage because of safety. If it would integrate, it could damage existing genes. And in this case, that is quite rare if you talk about AAV. If it would integrate into DNA, it could damage DNA, it could damage existing genes, and that could lead to tumorigenesis. So this chance is relatively small for AAV. And another pro is it doesn't matter which type of mutation you have. You just provide a healthy copy of the GEA gene. There are some drawbacks of AAV gene therapy. Once you do it, you develop antibodies to the AAV capsid proteins, and therefore you cannot repeat it. Some people, and in some countries, many people already have antibodies because it's a natural virus, and therefore they cannot be eligible for the therapy because the antibodies would neutralize AAV. So the first thing for AAV that people do is to screen, are there already pre-existing antibodies against AAV capsid, yes or no? If they are there, usually you're not eligible for the therapy. Another thing is, because it does not integrate, you will also lose it over time. And we still don't know exactly in human patients how long this period is, but it is inherent to the type of therapy that you will lose it. Another thing is that liver toxicity, if you target the liver, has occurred so far, and has also led to death. So there is caution even with AAV mediated gene therapy. It's considered very safe, but if you increase the dose too much, it can actually become quite dangerous. If you would target the muscle, you can also induce antibodies against the GEA protein. So that's also something to consider. And if you target cells that are dividing, you will lose the AAV gene therapy faster, because at each division, the AAV virus does not divide along. So you get two times less of the virus. If you would have, for example, 10 virus particles, after one cell division, you have 5. And another cell division, you have on average 2.5, etc. So if you have a growing child and you will give that child AAV gene therapy, you will lose the therapy really fast. So that is not a good idea. And it is very challenging also to reach the brain, even if you inject it in the brain, because it has to diffuse within the brain to reach all the parts. So that's AAV gene therapy. For lentiviral gene therapy, this has a different mechanism. In this case, the expectation is that it's a single intervention for a lifelong treatment. And the reason is that it integrates into the DNA. I come back to that. We have found, and I will show you later, that, and also other people have found, that it can also reach the brain. I will also show you how, besides the heart and the skeletal muscles. And that's for us a very important reason also to develop this further. It can prevent actually antibody formation to the GEA protein, because you get an immune tolerance induction. So if you would treat with enzyme therapy after a gene therapy, there are no antibodies formed anymore. Like AAV, it's independent of the GEA mutation. It has been shown to be safe in multiple clinical trials for other diseases. It should be suitable for any patient, irrespective of age. And what happens with AAV, that you are not eligible because you have antibodies, does not apply to lentiviral gene therapy. The disadvantages are, it is also an advantage, so it integrates into the DNA, so you don't lose it, it's lifelong. But if it damages genes in your DNA, it can also cause leukemia, for example. And that is a risk that is never zero, but the goal is to keep that risk as low as possible. For example, by not using a too high dosage. So this is something that always should be kept in mind. Another disadvantage of lentiviral gene therapy is the preconditioning that you need to do. This is a form of chemotherapy, and it's needed to enable the cells that you use in this case, and I will show you how it works, to engraft, because we are using a bone marrow transplantation in combination with a lentivirus. And this is needed to make it work. Nowadays, it's quite a standard procedure, but it is still something that requires hospitalization and is something to keep in mind. And nowadays there have been some cases of unfortunately of leukemia for certain applications, indicating that indeed the risk is never zero. But there have also been many trials that are completely safe. So it is very important to still keep this in mind. Okay, let me explain to how the lentiviral gene therapy works. It's hematopoietic stem cell mediated lentiviral gene therapy. And so this is actually the part where you use a bone marrow transplantation, and here you use a lentivirus. And this is the procedure. So we have here a Pompe patient where cells from the bone marrow are taken via the blood and are cultured for a short time in a laboratory. In the laboratory, they are treated with a lentivirus called LV here that contains the GEA gene. And the lentivirus is actually the way by which the GEA gene can incorporate itself into the DNA of the stem cells in your bone marrow that you are culturing here. So these stem cells now contain the GEA gene and then are actually given back to the same patient. Before giving them back, the patient is preconditioned. It's called myeloablation. And this is needed to create space in a bone marrow, so the cells have a chance to engraft. And that's like a classical bone marrow transplantation. And they will repopulate the bone marrow and will stay there for the rest of your life. And what happens then is that you actually establish a permanent source of enzyme therapy within your own body. So here are the hematopoietic stem cells or bone marrow stem cells, and they actually secrete the GEA protein in the blood, and the protein from the blood can then reach the muscle, skeletal muscle and the heart muscle, and can treat them like enzyme therapy that you now are getting, most of patients are getting via an infusion. You don't need infusions anymore. This is produced by your own body in the blood. So that is the first thing that happens. The second thing that happens is that it can also cross the blood-brain barrier. So here you can see a cartoon of a blood-brain barrier. This is the barrier in your brain that prevents molecules from the blood to enter the brain. And this blood-brain barrier is the reason why enzyme therapy given to the blood does not enter the brain. So this is like a cross-section of a blood vessel, and there are cells around these blood vessels that can lock it and close it, preventing molecules from entering here the brain. And this is the cartoon of it. And that is actually the door to visualize that the door is closed with enzyme replacement therapy for the brain. But what happens in lentiviral gene therapy is that cells from the bone marrow can actually pass the blood-brain barrier, and then they can differentiate in the brain to brain-like cells and stay there. And then they can secrete the protein into the brain and treat the brain with enzyme therapy. And that is a huge advantage because now we can also, besides the muscle, treat the central nervous system or the brain. And this is just another other way of showing it. So here again, we have the patient, we take bone marrow cells, You put the gene with a lentivirus, which is green, and then we have the corrected stem cells and we give them back to the patient. And to illustrate what actually happens at the cell level, so why the brain is treated, you can use GFP. GFP is like a marker for cells. It actually can be visualized under a microscope very easily. And if you do that, so we have done that in the lab, you can actually indeed see that after the gene therapy, you can identify green spots in the brain. And these green spots are caused by the GFP protein that we expressed in the lentiviral gene therapy. And that is to illustrate the fact that indeed cells can cross the blood-brain barrier and can home into the brain, and there they can cause correction of the brain. And this is an enlargement. So for the lentiviral gene therapy protocol, for many other diseases, this has already been developed. And this shows you an example of programs for other diseases using a very similar approach. And these have worked. And also this one for MLD, has now been approved by the EMA to treat patients with metachromatic leukodystrophy or MLD. And here you can see that it can actually be applied to different types of diseases. We have adrenoleukodystrophy, Wiskott-Aldrich syndrome, in immune deficiency, ADAS-Kit, and again. And all the patients here were safe, up to date, and benefited from the treatment. This also includes the brain. For example, here, the brain is targeted, and also here. So this also proves that not only in the lab, but also in human patients, this therapy has been shown to be able to treat the brain. So let's go to Pompe disease. I show you here the very first version. Actually, before I started to work on this in 2010, this was published. And this shows you a cartoon of the lentivirus that was used. So this is the GEA gene that is part of the lentivirus. And this is a sequence that drives the GEA gene and makes it to be expressed. It's called SSFV, and that's called the promoter. So it's the basic version. And in this graph, you can see glycogen. So glycogen is the product that accumulates in Pompe disease, which you don't want. And here we have different tissues. Wild cell stands for healthy. And here we have GFP again, so this is like a non-working lentiviral gene therapy because it does not contain the GEA gene. And here in gray, the one that that we are interested in, and this is your control, and this is your healthy. And so these are put in diseased mice, actually. And here you can see glycogen accumulation in the heart. If you don't treat them or a mock treatment, this is the level of glycogen accumulation that you get. And after the real treatment with the GEA gene, you get indeed a reduction of glycogen, but it is not complete. And the same goes for some other tissues. So like here's muscle, and in the brain, nothing happened actually. So it was working, but it should be improved. And I just told you that in the brain, lentiviral gene therapy works, yes. But for Pompe disease, unfortunately, we needed a higher efficacy before it would also work in the brain. So in the last years, we have made an optimization, and that has been published. You can also read it back in these publications. And this shows you a little titration from right to left for the different tissues, this is the heart, here skeletal muscle, and here brain. The concept is all the same. So we have the healthy mice, so there's no glycogen. So on the y-axis is glycogen. In the diseased knockout, we see a lot of glycogen in the heart, in the skeletal muscle, and also in the brain. And we made two improvements. In the black bar is basically similar to what I just showed you with the original version. And if you put a little bit more of the treatment, you can see a nice reduction of glycogen in the heart, in the skeletal muscle, but not in the brain, like I showed before. But then we made another improvement and we could completely get rid of glycogen in the heart, because here the white bars are completely at zero. And the same for the skeletal muscle. And an unexpectedly good working also in the brain. So cerebrum is brain. So this was for us a very important finding, because now finally we could also, with a very in a very effective manner, treat the brain in Pompe disease. And why is that? Well, maybe to go really fast here, the reason is that the modification that we made shows for a better uptake. So this is like an assay that you can do in a lab. And this band is a GA protein. And with the improvements, if you give the protein to cells, to muscle cells in this case, you see that more can be taken up by the cells compared to the original protein. And therefore it can, it is just more effective. Yeah, you can analyze the brain in different ways. Here you see some pictures also that we published. So you can see different parts of the brain. Here you can see the hippocampus. And if you really would zoom in, you see all purple dots. So this, you see here the big purple background with a lot of these purple dots, and all these dots are accumulated glycogen. And this you see in the untreated knockout, so with a GA mutation, and the unmodified gene therapy, you see not much happening. But after the improvement, we can completely clear all these dots here in the hippocampus. If you would zoom in here, this is the cerebellum, which is another part of the brain, and you get a similar picture. Another interesting thing is that you get kind of an inflammation of the brain in Pompe disease. And you can actually use different readouts to monitor the inflammation with these antibodies. And you can also completely restore that with the lentiviral gene therapy. Just another readout. And here you can see a comparison between glycogen content, glycogen accumulation, and dosage of gene therapy. And each dot is one experiment. So we did many experimental points. And you can see here for the tibialis anterior. So this is the skeletal muscle with the unmodified lentiviral gene therapy. It works. And then with the improvements, you can see that it works at a much lower doses completely here. And here you can see the similar plot for the brain, with the unmodified versions. There's no way, if you increase the doses, that you can really restore the glycogen levels. But with the improvement, it goes very fast to very low levels. And I'm not going to explain this one. That is a bit complicated, but actually this is a measure for antibody formation, which you can see here. If you would treat with enzyme therapy after gene therapy, that's what we did. So this is actually a treatment without the GEA gene. So you get indeed anti-GEA antibody formation, which you can measure in a laboratory. But if you do a lentiviral gene therapy with the GEA gene, you prevent completely antibody formation. And that is, of course, important, because if you would have a lentiviral gene therapy treatment and for some reason it does not work completely as you would like, you would like to give additional enzyme therapy, the advantage is that you now will not develop antibodies to the GA protein, which normally can be a problem because they could neutralize the therapy. We have actually found that at a very low doses of lentiviral gene therapy, which is actually not working at all to clear glycogen, you already get the immune tolerance induction. So that is like a positive additional aspect of the lentiviral gene therapy. All right. So clinical development part one, I just guide you a little bit through the all the steps that are necessary for clinical development. So the first step in this is to make a choice. What is going to be the final lentivirus that you are going to use for inpatients? Because there are several versions that you could consider, and you have to consider efficacy and safety. And this is one of the most important decisions, because it will decide, be critical for all steps that are subsequently performed. Then you need a way to produce a clinical version of the gene therapy product of the lentivirus. You cannot do it in the lab. So you need to do it in a very standardized condition, and you need to produce a lot, because a laboratory is different from a patient and from many patients. So this product needs to be made and needs to be tested. It needs to be clean. It still needs to be safe. In parallel, the clinical trial needs to be designed, and then you need to do a lot of paperwork to get permission to perform the clinical trial. And of course, you need the funding to do all this work. So in the meantime, you need to collect money to do it. Part two, you start to perform the clinical trial, and always in the beginning, the thing that you are testing is safety. While you are performing that, you can already prepare for the next clinical trial, which is based on efficacy. So does it actually work? And of course, you are going to measure that already from the start, but your official endpoint, clinical endpoint, as it is called, will first be safety. And if that's okay, then it will be efficacy. That you need to design again, and you need again to have funding and to do all the paperwork for that part. Then you need to perform the clinical trial, and then you can apply for market authorization at the EMA or the FDA for the European market and for the American market. So these are roughly the steps, and we are in the process of preparing for a phase one. So the first clinical trial based on safety. And then how can this reach patients? Because this is a very important point in our opinion. I didn't put it in the slides, but what now is the development globally is that for rare diseases, there's what's going on is that therapies are being developed that become available for a very high price. And there are many rare diseases, and there are many gene therapies in development. And you can just calculate that if you would have to pay millions per patient for each rare disease, for each patient, then society has a problem, financial problem. And it has already led to some problems in reimbursement of expensive therapies by the national insurance companies. For example, our minister has just denied a very expensive therapy, lentiviral gene therapy, for MLD, which I just described, just because of the price. And that has led us to do this in a different way. And so we have actually established a spin-off. It's called Lenticure. And Lenticure is a spin-off of the Erasmus MC, and is 100% owned by the Erasmus MC. And the aim is to develop gene therapy for rare diseases for reasonable and transparent prices. And Pompe disease will be the first that we will target. And we are also working on other diseases like Hunter disease. In contrast to a classical company, which has as an aim to make profit, because it is dependent many times on venture capital, which want a return of investment and a large return of investment, Lenticure does not have that aim. The aim of Lenticure is to bring the therapy to the patient and not to make large profit. And that is a huge difference. So it's like a social investment company. And we would also like very much to involve patients in this initiative. And we have already the agreement of the International Pompe Association to be part and to participate in all the aspects that are being performed now, and they will soon be engaged. And we plan to report on progress. How is it going with the preparation for the trial? When are we going to do the trial? And then when we do the trial, how is the trial going? And we need to report on a regular basis back to the patients, of course. And it would be great if you have any suggestions on this, you can already give them now, or you can approach the International Pompe Association and put your comments via them. So to summarize, we have developed an optimized hematopoietic stem cell mediated gene therapy using lentiviruses. And this is a promising novel therapy, especially for the classic infantile form of Pompe disease, but I have to stress it can also be used for any patients, for adult patients. It can correct heart, skeletal muscles, and the central nervous system, so the brain. It is platform technology. So by using another gene, you can also develop this for other metabolic diseases. We aim in-house development of gene therapy for metabolic diseases with the aim to have transparent and reasonable pricing. And therefore we have established Lenticure. And Lenticure will rely on non-dilutive funding. And non-dilutive funding means there's no aim to make a huge profit. And in contrast, the aim is here to really get it to patients and not to make money. So we have a large team to our disposal at the Erasmus Medical Center, both in the lab and in the clinic with Hans van Ploeg. And we have also a tight collaboration with the Leiden University Medical Center with Frank Staal, who are performing clinical trial for an immune deficiency with a similar strategy. And we collaborate with Hannover Medical School with Axel Schambach and Michael Rothe. And these are the funding agencies that fund this process. And that's the end of the presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Pijnappel. That was a wonderful presentation. I think you're presenting very intriguing ideas, not only in terms of a different approach to gene therapy than we're currently seeing, and also a different approach to funding research and to funding treatments. And I think both of those are very interesting. You're very right that treatments are very, very expensive, and reimbursement is definitely an issue in many countries. We already have some questions for you. And if anybody else has questions, please feel free to put them in the chat box. This one, the first question is not so much related to gene therapy, but rather to some of the data you showed regarding ERT decline. And the question is, with respect to ERT decline data shown, is there any idea to try to differentiate the data by progression at start? And this is in relation to the hypothesis, is that the later ERT start relative to onset of progression, the less effective it can be?
That's a very good question. And I don't know completely. The point is that this is a rare disease, and we have the data from a set of patients, the point when you make subgroups, then the variation is still very big, and it becomes more and more difficult to find anything that is statistically significant. And that's the disadvantage of working with a rare disease, because there are simply no more patients with more data available. So I totally agree, and it is actually generally believed, so there's consensus that the earlier you start, the better to prevent symptom onset. So far as I know, there is the results that I've shown are also going on, also when you start really early. And it is not the case that if you would start in a patient that's completely asymptomatic, you can completely prevent disease with enzyme therapy, unfortunately. So, but definitely there's an effect, and that also makes a lot of sense. If you already have a lot of muscle damage, it becomes very difficult to do anything about that. So the earlier you start, the better, absolutely.
Yeah, and I'm sure dose and age of you're looking at also have something to do with it. You know, maybe if you're on a lower dose, less effect. And if you're 50 when you start, maybe some decline could be associated with age.
True. Age is coming also as another thing. Of course, you get aging of your muscle, and that is what everybody has. And that will also play a role, definitely, your ability to cope with the disease. Yeah. But it is still the case that there are quite some differences that are patient-specific that are, so far, we cannot really explain, and that are independent on anything else that we can monitor. And that means most likely that you have that some patients are better responders than others. And I suspect one aspect that could play a role here is like modifying factors. So everybody's different. And why is that? Everybody has different DNA. So some people have strong muscles, some people have weaker muscles. I mean, you have difference within people, and therefore they're also different in their response to the disease. It would be, of course, very important to understand why the decline is happening. I think it's crucial, and also why the variation is there. Because if you can understand that, then you can also see if you can prevent the decline.
So, now talking more directly about gene therapy and that portion of your presentation, we had somebody ask, do the corrected stem cells become new muscle cells?
Do the corrected stem cells become new muscle cells? Ah, yeah, no, they don't. So that is it's also a very good question, because you have to really to make a distinction. We are here in this form of therapy talking about hematopoietic stem cells. And the hematopoietic stem cells are cells that are present in bone marrow, and they're responsible for making blood cells. And they are not making muscle cells. In the muscle, and I've also given presentations on that, there are muscle stem cells, but they are really different from bone marrow stem cells. So the bone marrow stem cells have already decided to make bone marrow cells or blood cells, and that's it. And the muscle stem cells have decided to make muscle cells. We are also working on therapies where we are trying to build new muscle using muscle stem cells. That therapy is still in a laboratory phase, and we are not ready for clinical development, because we need to increase the efficiency to make it really worthwhile for patients. But yeah, my dream is that we can do this the sooner the better. But right now we don't know yet how to do it.
But stay tuned, because I'm pretty sure we'll have a presentation on that at the AMDA IPA conference in May of next year.
Yeah, let's see where we get there.
Okay, how does the transplanted toad sequence differ from naturally occurring GAA? And are there any additional development challenges you have to consider? Modified for uptake, bloodstream stability, et cetera. And then there's a follow-up to that question. How does it differ from proteins used in historical ERT?
Yeah, so the difference that we use, so we are using actually the same protein as in the human body is present at the protein level. The coding sequence, so the DNA coding sequence is slightly different. It's optimized to make more efficient the protein, but the protein is identical. That's good to realize because there are different. There are some the same codes for the same different codes for the same protein, and by optimizing that, you can enhance the protein production. So that's what has been done here. That's not a game changer, I think. The major game changer is that we have fused an IGF-2 peptide to the GAA protein, and the IGF-2 peptide, and you can read this in these publications from that I cited in a presentation. IGF-2 peptide enables a better uptake in target cells in muscles. So the uptake from blood into muscles is strongly increased due to the IGF-2 peptide because it can bind to the mannose-6-phosphate receptor, but to a different domain. Because the other name for the mannose-6-phosphate receptor is IGF-2 receptor. And there are two domains, roughly one for mannose-6-phosphate, which is used in classical enzyme therapy, but if you would fuse the IGF-2 tag, it can bind to a different domain of the same receptor, and that domain is a higher affinity, so it can bind in a better way with a higher affinity. So that is a major reason why the optimized version works so much better. And I totally agree that for future, it would be very interesting also to go on this idea and to make, for example, to increase the stability in blood. And maybe there are some other things that could be done. However, at some point, you really have to make the decision to go into clinical development. Now we have such good results. This is what we are doing. But I could even think of many other optimizations that potentially could work, but then you have to test them and you can go on forever. Yeah. So, but in principle, these are very good ideas. Yeah.
No, and I think you're making a good point that you could continue going forever and ever looking for better and better ways to optimize. But if you found an optimization that produces really good results, you can't let future options prevent you from starting trials and helping patients.
Yeah, exactly.
Have you seen, or have he has seen some publications in collaboration with colleagues in China? Can you share anything about this? I suppose it's a different group than the ongoing AAV IOPD gene therapy trial that's ongoing there.
Yeah, I don't know exactly which one is referred to here. As I've explained, AAV and IOPD, so infantile onset Pompe disease patients, is really challenging. So, because they are still growing and then you are losing the AAV. So, in general, that is something that you better do in children that are a bit older. So I don't know exactly. I don't know the details about this. So yeah, I would have to see. We have some contacts with people in China, but not these people.
How does the IDF2, I think he means IGF2,
IGF-2.
affinity compare with the discussion on mono versus BIF in glycan? The improper profiles previously published for some of the existing ERT products, historical and recently approved.
Well, the IGF-2 is insulin-like growth factor. So that is a peptide which makes it independent on this glycan, like monosixosphate or glycan modifications. So that's the whole concept. So the whole point is that with enzyme therapy, the way it's produced is mainly using cells in culture. And those cells need to produce, overproduce a lot, the enzyme product, like the GA protein. And that leads to a certain, post-translational modification, as you can call it. So in an ideal case, you would have 7 monosixosphate groups on GA, and therefore it could be taken up by target cells. But in practice, there's a very complex glycosylation pattern. And yeah, the mechanism, it can also differ per enzyme, how efficient that process is. But the whole concept here is that it's completely independent on all these modifications, because if you have this IGF-2 tag, it doesn't matter anymore what kind of monosixosphate groups you would have, because it overrules that part, and it can be taken up via the IGF-2 part.
Well, I have a question, and I think I'm actually surprised nobody's asked it yet. When do you think you're going to start with your trials? Do you have a time frame?
Yesterday. But no, this is, of course, also for us still a question, because we are in a process of performing the steps. Mm-hmm. And I don't know what we are going to encounter. I hope that we can start late next year, early year after. But it really depends on external factors that we don't have completely on in our own hands. For example, you need to get all the permission to perform the trial. So you need to go to committees, and the committees need to decide. And they also take their time to evaluate your proposal. And that is a point where we have very little room to speed up, because, and if they ask additional questions, then we would have to address them before we are allowed to do the trial. So that is the uncertainty factor here that we are dealing with. You need to produce the lentivirus in a scale that is enough to treat an X number of patients. And you never know whether because it's one of the most challenging parts of gene therapy. So there have been also cases in which the production line, for some reason, had a production problem, and then there was not a good quality virus. So we really have to see and hope that it doesn't happen. That is also, of course, part of, okay, who's going to produce the virus, and what's going to be the procedure that is going to be used to purify the virus, and etc. So these are all almost non-scientific things. This is actually the whole process to take it out the lab and to make it into a clinical production phase that have their unpredictabilities. And another thing, of course, is the funding. Are we allowed, or are we able to collect enough funding for the phase 1/2 trial? That is usually still quite doable, but if you really go for market authorization, you need more funding. So we really need to engage also people who would like to participate in this, to be able to move really to the last stage, and to get it approved for market authorization, assuming that it is working as we, of course, all are hoping. Yeah.
And is the intention to start in IOPD, LOPD, both?
But that's also a good question. And we are now evaluating all the possibilities there. And we have not made a decision yet what would be here the best to start with. Yeah, there are many reasons to start with a certain patient population or not. And what, of course, is very important that there is already a treatment. And it's life-threatening. So if the therapy would not work, then the patient is at risk for dying. So that is also something compared to a new treatment for a disease where there's no treatment whatsoever, like the enzyme therapy first trial, relatively easy. I mean, the patient remained to live instead of dying. And that's a very easy outcome. And in this case, it's more complicated, of course. So we are really looking carefully now together with our clinical team. What can we do? What can we measure? What would be the best patient population to start with? Because we're going to measure efficacy right away. And of course, we want also to be able to measure that it works. Yeah.
Okay, so one final question. What is your funding target? And what are the criteria for participating? Are you only interested in grant-based funding? Or is it also possible for an equity stake or some other model of funding? Ooh. And second person asked the same question. How much money do you need to progress the gene therapy in a reasonable time frame?
Yeah, that actually is an excellent question. So the point is that nobody knows exactly what it takes to develop gene therapy like this one. And there have been a lot of discussions also on the prices that are now being asked by the industry. So why is the price so high for a therapy for rare disease? And so then you get a very blurry answer like, but we have a lot of failures and we have to pay for the failures. And nobody knows exactly what it now takes. Okay, straight this therapy, what did it take you to come there? So what we are also doing here is we will make a report of what we are going to spend here. And then at the end, we know. And so the short answer is we don't know how much money we need. We know now how much that we need. Of course, trials usually cost millions, right? It's also true that typically for lentiviral gene therapy trials, you don't need trials with you need for myozyme with 30 and 60 patients with a placebo control. The number of patients is much lower. So that will reduce the cost relative to a trial with so many patients, but we still don't know exactly, but I would advise people who are interested to contact me and we have a CEO now of Lenticure and we are setting up the business and then we can also discuss it and it will go in blocks. So for this block, we need this, for this block, we need that. And then we can take it from step to step, and that's what we will do. So please contact me and we can discuss this in a separate meeting if people are interested. Yeah. I have to excuse, I'm not completely familiar with all the constructions that would be allowed, but I think in general it is very as I can put it right now, there will be not like a typical, like it's also a new business model. So it's not like that people get invest and then they get a huge return. That's what I explained, right? We also don't want probably not shareholders, but more stakeholders. To prevent actually, if many people will get shares, then at some point it will become very, very, very difficult to maintain to the mission of the company. But there are many technical ways to do this. And this is not my expertise, but that's the expertise of the CEO. So there are many ways how people could contribute and still can do this in a way that they are happy with. And still probably, for example, a loan, and they can get that with a certain interest back if the therapy, because we are going to make That's the goal. Some profit, but the profit will be used to maintain the company and to make like a platform for rare diseases where we can also treat other diseases. And that's it. So there will be a kept,
in profit. Some ways, sort of like a nonprofit where funds raised go back into the community and to serve the purpose of the nonprofit.
Yeah, you could say it like that. Yeah. And and again, it will be. I think what I really like is the work that it's about stakeholders. So it's about people who are engaged in this. And venture capital is out; it's not allowed. And for the rest, people who adhere to this mission and don't expect a huge return of investment. Still, the money can still flow back. With a percentage, of course, and the form at which that occurs can be discussed, and again, there are many forms how to do it. Yeah.
Well, thank you, Dr. Pijnappel. It's been a very wonderful and I think thought-provoking presentation. You're introducing not only a new form of therapy, but also a new way to fund and deliver that therapy. So thank you very much for your time.
Thanks a lot.
With that, this concludes today's AMDA webinar. Thank you everybody for participating. Have a good day.
Okay, thank you.